My name is Sarah Woodbury, and today we're talking about the relationship between the French crown and King Edward I of England. This is the last video about our recent trip to France. Earlier videos have been more about the places we visited, and this is more about why we went. Part of the reason we went to France this year is to see places in France that were connected to the history of Britain, with which I am more familiar. Often when I write a book, I put in a whole bunch of historical background that I later delete because it gets in the way of telling a good story. So that's pretty much what you're getting today. King Edward, as a historical figure, looms large over my books, both the After Camari series and my new book, Crutchback. Because in the Middle Ages, the King of England was also the Duke of Aquitaine, not to mention Norman, Edward had ties to France even before he became king. France, however, didn't exist as we know it today, in that Aquitaine was a separate kingdom and the people were not French. Aquitaine had come under the auspices of the Kings of England after the marriage of King Henry II to Eleanor of Aquitaine in the late 12th century, as an addition to Henry's already extensive French estates, which included Brittany and Normandy. Over the next century, the Kingdom of France wrested all but Aquitaine away from the Kings of England. Thus, when Edward left for crusade from Aghmore, which we talked about in an earlier video, in alliance with King Louis and his son Philippe, he was leaving from French-held territory. Although Louis died before he reached the Holy Land, and Philippe decided not to fight anymore, Edward went on to Acre anyway. Despite the disintegration of the alliance, relations remained hospitable enough between France and England that Edward returned home through France with no concern about a threat to him. That came later, during the reign of Louis' grandson, also named Philippe. Although Edward had gone to Paris in 1286 and successfully brokered a peace deal between France and Aragon, after 1291, Philippe turned against him. The dispute was over the Duchy of Aquitaine, which Philippe declared forfeit under the excuse that Edward, whom he only referred to as the Duke of Aquitaine and not the King of England, hadn't sufficiently bent the knee to him. This will all be useful to know if you plan on reading the next book that's coming out in the After Camari series, Unbroken in Time. To avert war, Edward agreed to marry Philippe's sister and give up Gascony, which at the time was part of Aquitaine. The resulting treaty included a provision that Edward first give up all of Aquitaine to Philippe, after which Philippe would return to Edward the part that wasn't Gascony. Once Edward had done his part, however, Philippe refused to give Edward either his sister or Aquitaine. The result was a lengthy war between England and France. Edward brought an army to France to fight, reaching as far east as the area around Toulouse, and prompting the fortification of castles in French-held territory. At one point, French troops attempted to invade England at Hythe, though they were beaten back by the townspeople. And that was also a feature in an earlier book in the After Camari series. Along the way, both kingdoms went into debt, which it could be argued led directly to Philippe expelling France's Jewish population from the country and destroying the Templars, who were both his moneylenders. Hostilities were concluded by the Treaty of Paris in 1303, resulting in a return to the status quo of before 1294 and the marriage of Philippe's daughter to Edward's son, Edward II. All of this history is relevant to my book, specifically to the After Camari series, which we'll be talking about next week. If you like this video, click on the playlist or subscribe to my channel. There'll be a new video next week. And if you want to check out my books, click on the link to my webpage.